Yeah, so I'm taking JPEG first. I'm allowing you to speak JPEG. Please unmute yourself and you can ask your question.
Yeah, hi. Thanks, Mahavir. I mean, I like your platform a lot. I have two questions, actually. So recently, my parents are senior citizens and they have a comprehensive Star Health policy. And just recently, a couple of months back, my mom had an hospitalization claim in Star Health. And it was a very good hospital, which we admitted to. And when the final bill was settled, right, there was a lot of deductions. Now, the deductions came under custom and reasonable charges. They said that what the hospital is quoted is more than what the market rate is, basically. And there was a good amount of deduction happening there. So, I can understand it's mentioned in the policy document that, these are the custom and reasonable charges would be applicable. But, the difference amount, right, I was not ready, for such a huge amount coming up. I was expecting some difference. So how do we, prepare for that? That's first question. And second question was that, in the policy, single private room, right, that's applicable, which is a lot for my parents. But what I've saw in the hospital rate, right, depending upon the room, the procedure cost also increases, right? If you have a single private room, the procedure cost also increases proportionally. Is this a valid practice, and do insurers, honor this type of claim?
Right. So if I've got your question right, you have two questions. You have the first question is about reasonable and customary charges. Very interestingly, within Beshak, we've had a very long discussion on this amongst our team members internally. And, even people who have been in the insurance space were very surprised to hear about this clause, reasonable and customary. And, the first question that came is exactly what you asked is that, why should there be any kind of deduction if I have a renew premium policy that I've bought? What is the reason that I should go for when I have taken a policy, there should be a deduction which is so random, like reasonable and customary. So for that, the most important thing that you have to understand, and this is what came out from the conversations that we had internally, is that in India specifically, hospitals are not regulated, right? While there is a regulation on paper, but if you look at that regulation and how it's basically executed, hospitals do not have any control or regulation in how they charge, what kind of billing they do, and whether they are doing differential billing or not. There are no controls whatsoever across the country. So insurers specifically, because when you understand this part, you have to also understand that insurers are in the business of staying profitable, being able to add value to their shareholders as much as their job is to basically ensure that claims are paid. So from an insurer's point of view, if you look at it, while insurers would like to pay claims and ensure that their customers are happy and they keep renewing their policies, at the same time, they need to protect themselves from overcharging. If there is any overcharging that's happening, insurers would not have any kind of control, and that would not keep the product viable if they don't have that control. given that, if hospitals keep charging whatever they want to charge and insurers have to pay that charge in irrespective of whatever it is, it would be a very, very difficult and a very, very difficult model for an insurance company to survive it. Right? So hence this clause of reasonable and customary charges, which basically means that any hospital cannot charge more than the charge that any other hospital in that same geographical location and in the same grade, right? So if I'm talking, you're talking, you just mentioned that this hospital is a large hospital and is a very popular big hospital. A similar hospital in that area, if it is charging, let's say, 10,000 rupees a room, I'm just giving a random example, so that a hypothetical example. And if this hospital is, let's say, charging for the same quality of a room, let's say 20,000 rupees, and this is disproportionately higher, insurers, to protect themselves from such overcharging, have kept this clause of reasonable and customary charges. which basically allows them to protect themselves from any kind of overcharging, right? Because there is no forum where insurers and hospitals talk together and negotiate charges. Hospitals have, like I've been talking about this on Twitter also, is that hospitals, there is no control insurers or IRDA has over hospitals, and hospitals hence can charge anything. From the insurer side, the protection clause that they put is reasonable and customary. Now, the question that you would have or any customer would have is that, you know, how do I, you know, manage this? And what do I do about this? And the, if I were you, what I typically do is that whenever I'm going to any hospital or I'm going through any treatment, and if obviously it's a planned treatment, it's not an emergency treatment where I don't have any time. If I'm able to plan a treatment, then what I do is that I do check the charges before I enroll myself in a hospital. And I would request everyone, whoever has the time or the bandwidth to be able to do that, to go to, when you are planning admission in a hospital, to basically go to the hospital and understand the charges. Every hospital will give you an estimate of what is the kind of charges they would apply depending upon what kind of room you are going to select. So they will tell you that, okay, first choose your room, and based on the room they will be telling you that, okay, this is the approximate estimate of the charges that you will have to pay, this is the approximate bill that you will have to pay. Now, when you have this breakup available with you, and obviously if it's not an emergency and it's a planned hospitalization, you could check in the same area to find out whether a similar hospital in the area charges similarly or has lesser charges, or if there is a difference of only 10 to 20%, then it's absolutely fine. But if the difference is, let's say, in the tune of, let's say, 40, 50, 60%, then you will have to either negotiate with this hospital, telling them that, you know, these charges are very high, or you should look at an alternate hospital, right? So it is very difficult for anybody to digest this. But if you are able to do this, I'll say one thing, is that you should behave with an insurance similarly to how you will behave without an insurance. So how you make use of insurance should not change depending upon whether you have insurance or not. You should go for the best care, but you should still be prudent about what kind of charges are being charged, because from a point of view that you may end up paying for either deductions, or your sum insured can get exhausted, or in the long term, if everybody does this, the premium of the policies could increase very high, to a very high extent. So, long story short, what you need to do is try to see in situations where obviously this is possible, that you look at the charges and understand whether there is a discrimination between charges that are charged for a hospital with insurance and without insurance. Try to find through, everybody has one doctor friend, right? Meaning, I'm sure. So you could talk to any of your network, whoever you in your friend network, if there is a doctor, to check whether the charges are right or wrong. I've had this example where there was a person who had a kidney stone operation, and usually a kidney stone operation should not, and it was not a very, very, very serious operation, it was a regular operation, it should usually cost 90k to a lakh rupees. And this guy was charged almost like 4.5-5 lakh rupees. And just because it was in the COVID scenario, the hospital was charging such high cost. The immediate thing that I told this person is that, hey, you know, if you're going to go for such kind of a hospital where they're charging disproportionately 3x or 4x of the cost that a regular similar hospital would have charged, you will have deductions. There is a good chance that you will have deductions. So from that point of view, look at ensuring that either A, you'll find a better hospital which has a lower cost, or B, be okay with their deductions because there is overcharge. Hospitals will overcharge, be very careful about it. Insurers may not pay for this overcharge because they have also to protect their own interests. Right? That is the answer to your first question. Second question is where you mentioned that hospitals charge differentially for the kind of, depending upon the room that you choose. So if you are, let's say, choosing a general ward, the charge of, let's say, an X-ray could be $100. If you're looking at the same X-ray, but you are in a premium room, let's say you are in a private room, which is a single private room, the same X-ray could cost you like 400 rupees. This has been the case across board. Almost all hospitals in the country have this specific format where they charge differentially depending upon the room that you pick. This came from mostly, my theory is that this has come from the concept of cross-subsidization. So let's say rich people pay more, poor people pay less, and you charge higher to people who have higher capacity of paying, so that supposedly people who cannot pay can be cross-subsidized. So this is true in the entire country. This is not true in Western countries where costs are not differentiated. But in India, fairly, your point is right. Hospitals do charge proportionately. And this will continue till two things happen. One is that there is no regulation on hospital billing. And second is because of the fact that hospitals have no control. Insurers have no control over hospitals. So till this happens, all this differential billing business will continue to happen.
Okay, Mavi, thanks. I mean, the reason I asked the second question was very specific in my case was because although in my family's case, right, the room available is private room, but in that case, private AC room was not available. We had to go down, mm-hmm. Shared room we had to go. So right. if by chance I had to, if a private room was available, right, and the cost differential was around 1.5-2 lakh rupees, right, extra I would have to pay. So mm-hmm. in that case, on top of the already reasonable customary charges, right, I have to pay additional right. 1 or 1.2 lakhs, right, because they will not see the room. Do they see the room type when they're applying the customary and reasonable charges? Because they will say that operation, based on the room type, would the cost should be same, right?
No, sir, I got your question. You're basically trying to say that I have gone for a room which is lower than my eligibility. Will I get a benefit or would I have possibly got benefit of that? Is that your question? Meaning in terms of how reasonable and customary is looked at.
Correct. And second was, if I had gone for a private room, would the deduction would have been more under reasonable customary charges? If for the same treatment, right, if I got a single private room under the same clause,
the deduction would have been higher, obviously, because proportionately you would have had a higher deduction. Yes, that is my case. Obviously, you'll have to look at the bill, but you are right in your kind of guesstimate, saying that I would have had to pay more if I would have taken a higher room. Yes, that would have happened. And this is very unfortunate because currently insurers, because they don't have control over hospitals, plus there is no regulation, this is happening. And hence I mentioned to you is that we need to keep our eyes and ears open and negotiate with hospitals as far as possible, wherever it is possible. Obviously, if it's an emergency case, you can't do that. But wherever it's possible, you should do that.
Thanks, Mavi. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Who wants to go next? Please raise your hands. Okay, Lakshmi, I'm allowing you to speak. Please unmute and ask your question.
Hi, this is Lakshmi. I had a question related to term insurance, basically. If a main earner of the family is like has recovered from cancer or something, and further is no there is no chances of coming back, or there is no less probability from the doctor side, if they say, are they eligible to buy any type of term insurances? Most of them, I tried with some three four of them there, I see that they rejected based on that. Is there a way to buy it, or with any clause or something?
Got it. Actually, so unfortunately, the answer to this is no. Most insurers, at least this is obviously coming from my experience, is that insurers look at serious illnesses very seriously, if I could use say that. It is looked at a very binary level. And as soon as they see something which is a very serious illness, in India specifically, insurers don't provide insurance, be it term insurance or health insurance. And I know you mentioned the fact that there is a very low chance of relapse. I know for a fact that there are people who are survivors of cancer who could be earning members. But this is the reality, that there is a very, very low chance that you could get a term insurance once you are diagnosed or a survivor of cancer. My still, there is insurers are looking at cases at a case to case level. And my suggestion to you, Lakshmi, would be that be persistent, keep trying, because if the person needs or his family needs financial security, you should present your case to multiple insurance players, even the younger insurance companies which have, let's say, recently got launched, to basically reason with them, give them the documents that are required, or find a financial advisor who could help you through, you know, guiding you through the case, someone who's really experienced, who can, you know, go to multiple insurance companies and talk to them, even try LIC for that matter, to see if you can, you know, get a case. It will be tricky, it will be difficult, but I would still recommend, if I were in your place, that I would keep trying, largely from the point of view that you mentioned, that the cancer has very low chances of relapse, and hence, maybe some insurer could take a call of, let's say, charging a loading or putting some exclusion and still giving you the policy. So while I said that it is tricky, I would still say be persistent, try LIC and try multiple insurance companies, and also try to find a good financial advisor who could guide you through this process. And also let us know what happened maybe on the forum later.
Sure.
Yeah. Who wants to go next? Okay. Vignesh, I'm allowing you to speak. Please go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, good evening all. Thanks, Bhavi sir, for the opportunity. Before I ask my question, thanks for all the insights you have been sharing. It's been very helpful because I myself, in life, I had taken few health insurance without consulting or just as a banker told or something, but just want to tell you that the insights you provide are very, very helpful. My question, sir, is I was just going through some video where I saw there was a fundraising for a specific genetic disease for a kid where the whole cost of the medicine would cost around 16 crore, and I didn't believe it, and I started researching about that, and I came to know these things exist because the medicine is so much research, and the cost of that medicine importing to India is around 16 crores. Right. And there are every 10,000 kids, I mean, this disease gets into kids, at least 10,000, for every 10,000 kids, there is one kid which is getting affected in this way. So I just want to know, is there any specific insurance which covers this kind of God forbid things happen to some kids? Will insurance cover these kind of medical expense? Is there a clause where they can cover
this
thing, sir?
Yeah, it's a very, very good question, Vignesh. And very recently, we were studying this specific thing. This can be covered, and there is a positive side to it, and obviously some things that you need to understand from a limitation point of view. The positive side, the good side, is that yes, there are policies which can cover you for zero day baby cover. So basically what is that called is that if you take a maternity cover in your policy, let's say the waiting period is, let's say, 2 to 4 years in most of these maternity policies, and then there is a delivery of a baby, there are policies which cover what is called zero day baby cover, or give cover to a newborn baby, right? I'm just putting you on mute because there is some background noise. So the fact of the matter is, yes, there are covers available which can cover newborn babies. The way to do that is buying a maternity policy which covers maternity in the policy. And if there is a waiting period, after the waiting period is over, if there is a delivery of a baby, that baby can get covered under that policy. So that is the positive side of the answer. Now, the limitation of this policy. The limitation of this policy is that such policies which cover maternity usually have a limit of cover for maternity, which is in the range of most of the insurers give you a range of around 25,000 to 50,000 rupees, where maternity is covered for, let's say, a normal delivery and a cesarean delivery. Now, most of the policies cover the baby under this same clause. They basically say that it is covered under the same limitation. So unfortunately, while the cover is being thought through by insurers, but the cover limitation is very meager. It's almost like zero cover, because 25 to 50k maternity cover is available, but that is going to get used up in the maternity cost, and then there will be nothing that is left for the baby to cover. There are a very, very few policies which give you a limit of 1 lakh, and there is one specific policy which gives a limit of 5 lakhs. These are the only two policies where there could have been, you know, a larger limit available for the baby after she is born, right? So, answer to your question, cover available, limits are very, very meager. So, it's almost negligible cover that is available today. This is a very, very important cover that should be available, because the cost of when a baby actually is having complications after delivery, and or has any kind of condition that is developed after delivery, usually what I've seen is the costs are astronomical. They are extremely expensive. The cost could go to like 50,000 rupees a day also, right? If the baby is kept in a NICU, what it is called, baby, it's an ICU for babies, right? So from that point of view, it is a need for a lot of people who are young parents or people who have just got married, that they have such kind of cover available. Unfortunately, I'm breaking to you, and this is obviously something which is not good, but the limits that are available are not really significant enough for you to be able to depend on it. Hope that answers your question. Right. And next I'm going for Rahul Mittal. Rahul Mittal, please unmute and ask your question. Rahul, please unmute and ask your question.
Okay, sorry. Hi, Mahavir. Yeah. This question is regarding critical illness. I went through your recently released ebook also on that. So the question revolves around the practicality of usage of that policy, whether it is in the form of rider or standalone policy. First question is the practicality, what I read through the clauses that most of the diseases are covered at very advanced stage. So with your experience, what is the practicality of this policy? Second, if we take a standalone policy of it, I understand that it runs like a medical policy, and every year or basis year of age, this policy premium will get or keep on revising. So at the age of around 45 to 50, it will cost a bomb to hold that policy somewhere around 40,000-50,000, what I've seen from the premium charts. So how differentiate method and rider, taking a rider with term insurance fixes it for the whole duration for next 30-40 years. So is it too different to take a rider and a standalone policy from the coverage point of view? These are two my questions.
Sure. So the first question is around high, meaning because most of these policies will cover only higher stage of critical illness. Now, from a financial point of view, you check with most of the people who have had, let's say, early stage critical illnesses, the costs mostly are related to surgery, and the costs are related to some amount of medication, right? Vis-a-vis someone who has been, let's say, diagnosed with a higher stage, let's say, for example, higher stage cancer, the treatment cost could be extremely high. The financial risk about losing a job or maybe not being able to continue with a high stress job and hence having to curtail their income is also very high. And the regular expenses incurred on medication could also be high. Today, critical illness covers you for the high financial risks, right? That is how you should look at it. For the lower stage diseases, like for example, typically what mentioned in the ebook, and people who want to are interested in downloading this ebook, they can go on our website, and the ebook is now available on our website under health insurance tab. If you are someone who is looking at buying critical illness, then you should be very, very clear that you are covering for the high, large financial risks. And only in cases like cancer or certain diseases, there will be specific definitions which will say that only a specific grade of critical illness will be covered. And that is somehow from our discussions with people who are actuaries, people who have experience in the field of serious illnesses from the medical side. That's where the costs go very high, right? That's where when the disease becomes extremely, reaches a higher stage and it's not an early stage, is when you will have financial risks which need to be covered. And hence we feel critical illness is a good policy to buy, even if they cover only high stage or cover severity above a certain grade, right? That is the answer to the first question. Second question that you asked is between standalone and the critical illness rider, there is a difference in how premiums are charged. And that we released a term insurance ebook about 6-8 months ago. And in that we had mentioned that, you know, standalone critical illness is a better policy to buy. Because in standalone critical illness policies, you will be able to cover even early stage diseases. After we released this book, we had multiple conversations with people from medical fraternity and from actuaries. And what we've learned is that, like I mentioned, that financial risks are higher for the higher severity cases. Financial risks are higher for the state when the stage is higher in the disease. From a point of view of pricing between standalone and your rider critical illness, although the rider critical illness covers you only for higher stages, the premium difference between a standalone critical illness and a rider critical illness is significantly high. Meaning, that's what we did a lot of research on, and that's where we came up with this critical illness ebook to basically substantiate that there is a huge compelling difference between how premiums will be charged in a standalone critical illness versus a critical illness available as a rider. And that's where we feel is that when you look at it from a cost benefit standpoint, and if you're looking at it from a term point of view of being able to sustainably pay premiums, critical illness riders become compelling proposition looking at covering higher magnitude of risk or financial risk from critical illness, which basically from loss of jobs, also cost, regular cost of medicine, and costs which are not covered in the health insurance. So from that point of view, Rahul, my answer is that go for a rider critical illness, just understand it well, read the ebook, and there are a lot of areas where you should look at before you look at a critical illness rider also. But in our view, if I was you, I would, looking at the premium difference, I would go for a critical illness rider versus going for a standalone cover after reading and understanding the terms and conditions, of course. Does that answer your questions?
Yes, Mahavid, precisely. Thank you. It's very helpful. So I am also, from cost of point of view, thinking of taking a rider. And second question, one more question. I am currently corona positive. So hopefully after in a week's time, I would be getting a negative report to it. So what is the waiting time to apply for term insurance now in these scenarios?
So there has been multiple different kinds of reports that we are getting from multiple people, customers, insurance companies. Some of them say that they want to wait it out for 6 months. Some of them say wait it out for 3 months. Some insurance companies are even saying that, come after 2 weeks, 4 weeks, right? So what you'll have to do, Rahul, is that go and do a check with multiple insurance companies and know from the horse's mouth, because it is a very dynamic thing and it is connected to reinsurance, and hence it is continuously changing. So it's better that whenever you are finalizing that, okay, these are the 4 or 3 insurance companies that I would like to look for, let's say, and then go and check with each of them and get to know the updated underwriting that they are following. That would be my suggestion. Right now, what I know is that insurers are very nervous or about and showing a lot of nervousness in covering post-COVID or COVID survivors or COVID history people, because There are a lot of studies going on which say that, you know, people with COVID background will have after effects. And that's not very clear because the studies are all in work in progress. And hence reinsurers plus insurers, everybody is right now in the wait and watch mode. And hence there are chances that you would face, let's say, insurers coming and back and telling you that, okay, wait for 5 to 6 months before, you know, we can look at covering. That's what I foresee, but you should still try.
Okay, thank you. That is really helpful. Thank you for.
Yeah, Ajit Parihar, I'm taking you next. Please unmute and ask your question. Okay, Ajit Parihar,
hello.
Are you? Yes, Ajit.
Hi. Good evening, everybody. Sir Mahavir, sir, I have question regarding critical illness, which you have discussed, and you are also released some ebook. I tried to download, but I didn't get. But my question is, there are life insurance company and non-life, both are selling such products. So just need to know which one should be considered. And there are some specific disease specific product also available.
Correct.
Like cancer, and, you know, heart, like dengue also is there.
Yes. It's a good question, Ajit. First of all, if you've not received the ebook, do check your promotions folder or do check your spam folder. Hopefully, it should not go in the spam folder, but do check that. And the second thing is that answering your question is insurers from general insurance as well as life insurance provide critical illness. Which one should you go for? General insurance companies will offer critical illness mostly as a standalone policy, or it could be an add-on, which could be a part of health insurance. Similarly, on the life insurance side, life insurance companies also provide specialized policies on critical illness, which are standalone policies, and there are policies which are available as write-off. What we would suggest is look at each of them on an individual basis, whatever you're looking at, and understand the terms and conditions from 2-3 standpoints. One is that how many illnesses are covered. Minimum 10 to 12 illnesses should be covered in the policy. Mostly 10 to 12 illnesses would take care of 90 to 95% of critical illness related claims that come in the country. So that should cover you well. The other things is that you should look at whether they are covering you on accelerated basis or they're covering you on a single separate payout basis in case of riders, and understand this well. It's mentioned well in the ebook with examples, so do read that and understand it well. There is no specific answer to this, that whether you should go for general insurance or life insurance, because both the policies, both in both category of insurers, can provide similar policies. There is no regulation which disallows general or life insurance to provide a competitive policy which can be competing with a general or life insurance. So look at them as individual options that are available to you and evaluate them basis the ebook. After you've read the ebook, you can evaluate them based on ebook. If there are any specific questions that come up later, you could basically may come and ask us on the forum. So that's what I would recommend. There is no specific thumb rule answer that go for general insurance or life insurance.
Underscore, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Who's going next? Suchit Yadav. I'm allowing you to speak. Please unmute and ask your question.
Suchit. Hello.
Yes.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Thank you, sir. So there are few questions. So first, starting, my age is 22. I've just started earning from last year, and I live with my parents. So their age is 56, and my mother's age is 56, and father's age is 69. So my question is, first question is, would my parents get any Mediclaim, or if there is any benefit for getting Mediclaim for them? Second question is, what kind of Mediclaim and term plan should I get, because I'm the sole earner, and if I'm not there, there will be no source of income for my parents. So these are the questions for now.
Right. Sure. So thank you. Suchit, the thing is that you should definitely have a mediclaim for your parents and yourself also. But very critically, it's important that you go for and ensure that your parents are covered through a good mediclaim policy. How do you go about looking for these policies? Because you said your mother is, if I'm not wrong, you said 56 or
yes.
The age of your mother, and 69 is the age of your father. So for your mother, because she's less than 65, there are a lot many more options available in the market, because she is still in below the age where go ahead, hold on. So I'll answer your question. So you should first thing that you should do is that you should look at both of them separately. You should not look at them together, because your father and your father has an age which is 69, which will have very different kind of policies available compared to 56, which your mother will get. So first of all, find policies for your mother, which could be way better policies, because your mother is younger and she will have more choices available. Almost every choice that is available to you is available to her. I'm obviously assuming that they don't have, because you've not mentioned any disease.
Okay.
I'm assuming that they don't have any disease, and hence for your mother, you should go for
my mother has diabetes, and like just starting to get arthritis on joints. Actually my father was last year he suffered from stroke, so that was severe actually. So I have less hope for getting mediclaim for him, but I think I can get for my mother, right? So if there is any mediclaim for father, they will charge more, right? Because he has went through that illness.
Yes, got your question. So now that I have the medical history for your father, it's like you rightly said, there is a very low chance or very difficult for your father to get health insurance, specifically because she's suffered a stroke. For your mother, you would, because she has diabetes, and now that you said she has early signs of arthritis, you will have to go urgently and look for an insurance. We have on our website an article which is senior citizen health insurance. You could search on the website, and it has multiple options available which you could look at step by step, and it has a step by step method of how you could go about finding the best insurance for your mother. We also have mentioned the plans that are available for each step, and you could go by that method. You will, again, because your mother, you said, has diabetes, there are chances that a couple of insurers could say no or decline your case or ask for higher premium. Ensure that you go by those steps and look at the policies from the brands that are available. You should be able to find an insurance. For your mother, it is going to be, for your father, it is going to be very, very tricky to get a policy. For your question related to term insurance, I would request you that you download our ebook that is available on our website and understand term plan first well, because that will give you a good insight. It is a visual ebook, you will not take time to read. And then for choosing products, you could use our ratings product and understand which policy or which brand or which kind of plan is suitable for you. So my request to you is, because that's a very important product that you should buy for your family security, download the ebook first, and then second, you can, once you've understood the plan, then you could look at Beshak ratings and choose your plan.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, Sudeep Garg, please ask your question. Please unmute and ask your question.
Hi, Mahavir. Thank you for doing this. I think it's a really noble gesture. My question was regarding health insurance, and how do we choose between a private versus a public limited company like an Oriental or a New India Assurance? And a married couple, should they go for individual policy or a floater policy?
Right. Sure. So, from a private versus public sector company, what you just mentioned, I think how you should look at it is largely from the first thing, very important is that insurance company is less important. First, the terms and conditions of the policy are super important. So from that perspective, you should first understand that your policy has the least amount of financial limits. Your policy does have, you've taken an adequate cover for your family. That's very, very important. Once you've taken that decision, then you should come. Then based on that, public sector versus private sector does not make a very big difference. The only one single difference I have seen in my life is that public sectors usually use a third party administrator. Private sectors, most of the private sectors have moved to an in-house claim settlement, and hence there could be a difference in the claim servicing experience between a public sector and a private sector. But from a product standpoint, it could be equally good. You should basically evaluate products irrespective of whether they are public or private and take a decision based on the having less financial limits, like not having room rent limits, not having any other kind of limits in the policy, and having adequate coverage that should be available to you. The second question that you asked is around family floater versus individual. In my view, both are equally good options. What I do and what I have done for my own case is that I think, let's say, a family who's of, let's say, two adults should individually have 10 lakhs cover. What I would recommend, if that is the case, and if you're thinking that to buy individual cover of 10 lakhs for each of the adult members in your family, then buy a 20 lakh floater. What it does is that it has individual cover also that is available, and it also gives you a double cover in case there is a high severity or a very large hospitalization that happens. So my suggestion, look for the minimum individual cover that you're looking for both you and your wife, and then multiply that by 2x and then take a floater for that amount. That will give you the best of both worlds, individual as well as floater.
Thank you. Just in your experience, having a TPA good or bad?
Oh, okay. Yeah. Having a TPA in my experience has been an average experience. There have been cases where because there is a disconnect between there are already two parties in a health insurance, right? The hospital and the insurer. Having a third party, which is a TPA, has usually been an average to a below average experience for me, and hence I usually recommend products which do not have a TPA.
Sure. Thank you.
I'll take next question from TK. TK, please go ahead and ask your question and unmute yourself. Okay, anybody else? I think I can't.
Hi. Sorry, I was trying to speak. I was on mute.
Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
Sorry about that. Thank you so much. First of all, your inputs have helped change the perspective towards medical insurance, at least for me. So the question that I have is specifically on the pre-existing diseases or conditions, right? So what I notice is when you try to apply online, there's just like a one column, a yes or a no, and one field, right? In some place, to just ask you what the condition is. And
in some cases, there's some background voice. I can't hear you properly, TK.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. Okay.
So I was saying specifically on the pre-existing. So in some cases, I've noticed that there's no.
No.
The policy, for example, they ask you, do you have high cholesterol? There's no limits given on the values of what a high cholesterol is.
So TK, the problem is that I'm not able to hear you well. There is some network issue on your side. I can take your question again once you are in a better network. Is that fine? Because I'm not able to kind of hear you well.
Sure.
Yeah, your voice is getting is cracking actually. Who else? Panduranga, I'm unmuting. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello, is it audible, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir. My question is that for my family members, I have taken two health insurance policy. First is the base policy of 5 lakhs, and I took that in 2017. After having 3 years of no claims, the sum assured has automatically increased to 8 lakhs. So that is the base policy, and after that I have taken a super top up policy, like 5 lakh is the deductible, and after that I am having 20 lakh cover. My doubt is that let us say if there is a claim of 10 lakhs, I think I am eligible to get a claim from, and the thing is that the policy I have taken from two different insurers. In this case, how has been your experience, sir? Because I have to deal with two different insurers, and I also thought of the portability option. But the thing is that they said that if you are, even if you have declared everything, if you have paid 8 years of insurance with a same company, then they can't reject on some other reasons like that. I have studied one thing. So what has been the experience if you deal with two different insurers, and whether and this is a both are family floater policies. Even the base policy is a family floater policy, and even the super top up is a family floater policy. Yep. So the total cover will be like 25 lakhs. So whether that in a metro city, whether 25 lakhs will be sufficient, or because that is including my parents. Parents are aged 55 and 50. Myself is 24, and younger sister is 20. So yes. I need to take a separate.
I'll answer your question. So first question you have asked is that if you have two insurers who are whom you have bought the base policy and the super top up policies individually from, what is the experience that you have? The only expectations that you should not have is to be able to make cashless claims in both these policies. You most probably will have to go for one policy to claim one policy in cashless and the other on reimbursement. That is the first understanding you should have, and not have expectations to be able to do cashless in both. Apart from that, depending on the kind of policy you have, the experience or the deductions or the payment will be done. So there's nothing to worry about beyond having a disruption in cashless. Maybe you have to go for one cashless, one reimbursement. Apart from that, there is no other problem that you will face if you've understood the policy well and you know what are the limitations in the policy. That's the answer to the first question. The second question that you asked is what is the cover you should have? If you have a floater policy where both of you are also, your brothers are also covered, and your parents are also covered, and you said your age is between 20 and 25 is what I understand. My suggestion would be, in the long run, you should continue with this policy, but let's say by the time you hit 25, you should have your own policy and let this policy, which is the cover of close to 20-25 lakh rupees, you keep it exclusively to be used only for your parents, and don't use that policy for yourself. Don't depend on that policy for yourself. By the time you hit 25, try to see that you have your own separate policy and continue your parents that, and consider this policy that you currently have as your parents' policy.
Oh, okay. Sir, and another doubt is that many are saying regarding this portability option, already if you are having insurance with one company, that is different. As I mentioned, that is different from the super top up. So already 4-5 years we have paid in the company. Now if you want to port, will there be any issue, or there will be no issue, sir?
Yes, so porting for people who are senior citizens or people who are above 50-55 years of age, and specifically people who have had claims or have any kind of medical history, has been very complicated and tricky. It's not really easily available. Most insurers do not want to take portability cases, has been my experience, wherever these kind of situations where the either the age is very high, or there have been claims, or there is any kind of medical history. So it's better that you go and rest with an insurance company while your parents are healthy and you are healthy. Ensure that you are the best insurer before illness kicks in. That's something that we usually recommend. Yeah, I'll take the next one.
Sir, and
Panduranga, I'll have to take the next question and then we can come back to you.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure, sir.
Yeah. Yes, I just unmuted. I just put someone on.
Good evening. My question is that, does IRDA really have any power to control hospitals? We are seeing rampant cases where cashless decline, all this is happening. So is there really any power?
It's a one word answer, no. No powers. IRDA only regulates insurers. IRDA does not have any powers. Insurers also don't have any powers. Hospitals obviously have the upper hand. in this situation because of two reasons. One, no regulation, and second, because the business that happens for a hospital is not dependent on insurers. Insurers control only 15-20% of the revenues of hospitals. Not
in
like
this
where
scenario, yeah. In ahead. This scenario, do you think there is an opportunity for something like a CIBIL where insurers can come together and rate hospitals? Do you think
there is already an effort going on there? It's called Rohini. You could search online, Rohini, and that's where they are trying to work on this kind of a thing where they will rate hospitals and their experience. But please understand, RR, from a point of view, when you are looking at a hospital or when you choose a hospital, you are not really worried about, you know, the experience. You are more about the claims experience. You are worried about the care that you get and whether you are getting treated by the best doctor. So people, I don't foresee people looking at any kind of rating that an insurer is doing on hospitals before they choose a hospital. That's what I feel.
One more small question is, banks are selling a kind of a group plan with a flat rate for, say, up to 45 years. It is the same premium you pay. Group health insurance plans for customers. Do you think that this renewal premiums will remain the same, or do you foresee that companies will jack up the premiums in future?
Group health insurance products are products where you are dependent completely on the negotiation that happens between the insurer and the bank. Depending on the claims experience, the insurer could try to increase rates. There have been cases where insurers have been pulled back from a relationship with banks, right? It has happened multiple times. If a bank gets merged with another bank also, there are plans which get discontinued. There have been multiple cases. Today, as we speak, Citibank, because it's moving its retail business out of India, all the people who have bought a Citibank-based New India health insurance policy, nobody knows what's going to happen with that, because there is no clear-cut transition that will happen for sure. There is a good chance, hopefully, things, a good bank is taking over the business and there will be a good transition. But today, everybody's on tenterhooks. Nobody knows what's going to happen. And that's why it's not advisable to depend on bank policies if you have a choice. If you don't have a choice, then it makes sense.
Thank you.
We will answer all questions, so you don't need to worry about the time getting over at 8. Ensure that everybody's questions are answered, so please hold back. I think I'll take Kautilya next. Yes, Kautilya, I put you on. I hope I'm pronouncing your name right.
Yes, Mahavir. I hope everyone at Team Bestek are healthy and fine. So
yes,
I have more of a curiosity related question. So the first one is, in case of a demise of a person, if the nominee or the relatives of that person is does not have any documentation or the proofs of insurance that then insurer is being paid, paying. So what is the procedure for them to get the sum insured? I know that nowadays EIA policies are, EIA accounts are there, but they are not available for everyone. It's a sign up basis. So what was prior to that? And my second question is more about how does health insurance works for ultra HNI people? Like someone who has a lot of travel activities going abroad and things like that. So I know that some cards cover a few of these air ambulance charges and all, but still, how does this thing work for ultra HNI? Thanks.
Yeah, so the first question is that, let's say someone has a term insurance policy and the person passes away and there is no document available, the policy bond is not locatable. The first thing that can be done is obviously to be able to, you should, if you are able to identify the insurance company, it should not be very difficult for you to be able to reach to that insurance company and engage with them in terms of telling them that their documents are not available. It could become little tricky. There may be some indemnities that they may require you to sign. There could be extra paperwork that you may need to do, but insurers, all insurers in India are digitized, and hence all your details, including the LIC, the details are available with them on a digitized mode. Not having a physical copy is not going to be a technical reason why someone will not get the claim. The nominee details are registered with the insurer. If you are able to go with your photo ID proof and establish that you are the nominee, it should not be very difficult for an insurer to pay you the money. So it's not challenging at all. Only thing could be maybe a couple of additional paperwork that would be required to be done. Ultra HNI, what kind of health insurance options they have? I think Ultra HNI is typically there are policies which are high sum insured policies up to 3 crores that are today available. That's what my knowledge goes to. And plus, there are policies where you know you can get coverage for treatments for critical illness outside India. So Ultra HNI usually are looking for policies where they can also get treated not only in India but outside India. Ultra HNI look for products where there is a high coverage, no limitations. Kind of a policy. That's what I know. Ronak, I'll take your question next. Please unmute yourself and answer. Yeah, you're welcome.
Yeah, hi Mahvir. So in critical illness rider, section 45 will apply in life insurance case. So that might be advantage or something like that?
No. Critical illness will not apply for section 45. That is a separate, though it's a part of the policy, it will not, the claim adjudication will not, section 45 will not be applicable to critical illness. That's a very interesting question, but no. In my opinion, it will be looked at separately. The adjudication will, it's only, section 45 only for that claim.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Yes. Anybody wants to raise hands, we'll take two more questions and then we close for the day.
Hello, Amir, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Hi, Mahvir, this is Tam.
Yeah. Yes.
Hey, thank you, Mahvir. Really appreciate all your input. And you know, really, it has changed the perspective towards insurance. So, I wanted to specifically ask on the pre-existing diseases, right, the column when you have it in the health insurance. So what I've noticed is many a times there is no clarity in the policy documents or in the terms and conditions on what you should disclose. So for example, pre-diabetes, high cholesterol. So it's like just left there. And many a times when you do a regular health checkup, you might realize some of the parameters are not in place. And there's no medication for that, but still are we expected to present all the details? I've read your forums, you've said you should mention, but when we apply online, there's hardly any option given for you to explain the condition, right? That, hey, this is really not a disease right now, I'm on the edge, but maybe we are controlling it. So is there any comments on, because online, the experience seems very difficult to explain your stand when it comes to pre-existing and balancing between telling them the full disclosure, right? So how do we balance?
Yeah. So your question, if I've understood right, is basically that there are very limited questions and very checkbox kind questions that an insurer is asked about a specific thing. Then how do you go about elaborating that, okay, this is not a very complicated stuff, this is in control and all those things. So how it works is that the proposal form that an insurer creates is basically the initial information that an insurer needs before it starts evaluating your case. So your job is to answer the questions to the best of your knowledge and ensure that you have whatever questions have been asked, you've answered them well. That is the first thing that you should do. Based on those questions, there would be you could get a call after that question from the insurer's doctor panel, or you could get a call from their underwriting department, or there could be a video call that could happen, or there could be additional information that they may ask. So from a specifically, strictly from a health insurance point of view, your job is answering all the questions well on the form. And if they ask you any other questions beyond that after the form is filled, those also you should answer to the best of your knowledge. Give as much information that you can give, even send emails if required whenever they ask for additional information, give them reports, documents, everything. But beyond that, once you have answered all their questions, either it's on a phone or it's on a form, your responsibilities end. You do not have to, you know, go beyond that to answer questions or give information to an insurer. It's the insurer's onus to ask you the right questions before, you know, for them to evaluate your case and not the other way around.
Okay, sure.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. KLN, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
It's not a question. I just want to share my experience with recent renewal on health insurance. Okay. During 2019, I bought Liberty General health insurance policy, both base as well as super top-up policy. And I did buy as a multi-year policies, base as 2 years and super top-up as 3 years. So it was due for renewal in April month. So when I renewed, I the number seems to be not absorbed yet, because I read out all the policies and projected my premium for throughout my lifetime, and I sense that the numbers are not matching with the numbers that I have projected. So I was thinking that if there is any premium change, so I referred the IRDA website and downloaded the latest premium chart, and I did verify the numbers are also not changing. So I found that the portal, the insurer portal, has issues with respect to the calculation of premium amount for multiple years. Actually, it was profitable for me. Instead of providing a 7% discount, they were providing 2 times 15% discount. Actually, for 2 years, it's just 7%. Instead, they have provided 15% discount. So that one, that was one issue I found. And also, there was one more issue which I found once the policy I received. It was with respect to the loyalty perks. The loyalty perk should be 10% every year. So if I take a 5 lakh policy, it should be 50,000. So since it is a 2 year policy, it should be 1 lakh. So in that also, they have mentioned as just 50,000 as loyalty perks. So never assume that all the calculations given by the insurance are perfectly right. We need to know the policy wordings and ensure that everything is right. So these issues I reported and got rectified.
Right, excellent. I think I've seen those on Twitter also. I think on Twitter on this, and this is great actually. It's great that people should also be vigilant about what is going on and just not depend on. Finally, insurance companies are also run by human beings, and there can be errors, there can be issues. So it is excellent that you've actually been able to do that. Many of us blindly pay premiums, so it's a good input. Thank you. Skyrise Wealth Services,
hello,
you are next, and this is we'll take this as the last question.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, first of all, thank you for arranging this webinar and clearing all the doubts and supporting and help. So I have a personal query. I am 58 and my husband is 63. So we had health insurance since last 10 years. So that time we had a 5 lakh family floater with the public sector and a top up of 15 lakh with the private sector. So today I feel that this is not sufficient. So, and presently, the thing is, my husband has got BP, diabetes, and cholesterol, and I have only cholesterol. So, how do we, make this as a sufficient medical cover? Whether portability will help, or and we have checked with the existing public sector, they are not ready to increase the sum assured.
Right. Yeah. So yes, got your question. What I would do in your case. Is that that would have been my first thing that I would have done, is that I would have gone to the base insurer and tried to persuade them to increase my sum insured.
Correct.
Whatever best is available, but you're saying that they are not ready to increase the sum insured. The next option is to look at increasing your top up cover. So from 5 lakh, 15 lakh, can you look at increasing it to 5 lakh, 20, 25 lakh? That is the other option that you could basically explore.
So, the presently top up is 15 lakhs.
Yes, so you could maybe look at upgrading your top up, right? From 515 to, you could make it 525, 520.
But again, actually, it is from the private sector. I was thinking to do something under one insurer only, so that it becomes easier, like the base as well as the, and this also is top up, it's not a super top up. So I want to make it as a super top-up and base policy under one insurer. So is there any possibility whether portability would help?
yeah. So, with, given the conditions that you mentioned, that the BP, diabetes, and cholesterol plus the age for your husband, and plus he's about 60 years old, 63, yeah. 62 years old. It is going to be tricky. Plus, most portability, in my view and my experience, it's super difficult to get portability once there are diseases, plus the age is high, and plus if there are, let's say, if there are claims. Even if there are no claims, still it's typically very difficult to, yeah, but there is typically very difficult to get portability. My suggestion would be that you try to convert your 15 lakh private sector top up to super top up if you can, and plus try to see if you can upgrade that. That is the best bet that you have. Super top up is something that maybe another insurer may be willing to look at. So you could also try to see if you want to evaluate another super top up, maybe have one more super top up beyond these two policies that you have, which could be, let's say, 5 lakh to 20 lakh or 5 lakh to 25 lakh. And there you could look at buying, instead of buying a top up, buying a super top up.
Okay, so in that case, since I have a base policy with Oriental, and Oriental also has a super top up, so can I take super top up from them? That would that be better?
Yeah, you can apply. You are saying your base policy is from Oriental, so you could look at super top up also from Oriental. But given the fact that you mentioned that they are not ready to increase your base cover, that is the same.
For super top up, there is no problem.
Yeah, so if they are giving you super top up, then yes, you should go ahead and then port your super top up policy to Oriental with a higher cover as much as you can.
And another thing I was contemplating, should we have an individual policies? Like I go with around 30-40 lakhs, and he can continue with the existing setup. My husband can continue.
That could be a good strategy. What you could do is that this policy, you could keep it for your husband. And if you do not have any illness or disease, you could basically be, and you are under 60 right now, you could look at a separate policy for yourself. And consider this policy to be only for your for use of your for your husband. Yes, that's something that you could do.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I think we'll close for the day. I hope this was useful. If it was useful, do share a thumbs up on the channel. It will help us, give us a little more motivation to do such more voice chats in the future. Thank you very much for everyone joining in. Have a great evening. Bye-bye.